Thanks to CuriosityStream for sponsoring this video. Watch thousands of great documentaries and the extended version of this video on Nebula for just $15 a year.
Happy birthday to you.
What you're watching is 6'7" former NBA player Dennis Rodman singing happy birthday to the Supreme Leader of North Korea, Kim Jong-un. It's January 2014, Kim has just turned 31, and the crowd of 12,000 Korean speakers isn't sure how to respond, but eventually starts clapping along with the Americans, who its government regularly threatens with nuclear war. This was neither the first, nor last, nor most bizarre visit by Rodman to see his best friend. He would also hold the dictator's newborn daughter, discover highly coveted state secrets, party with North Koreans, and be credited with the release of several prisoners. In total, he would make 5 separate trips, each somehow more insane than the last, and all against the advice of the American government. Amazingly, each set of visits was set in motion by a different set of strange and unlikely coincidences involving so many absurd characters that it almost doesn't seem real. How did Dennis Rodman contact the North Korean government? Why did he return so many times despite immense public backlash? And is his friendship more a valuable diplomatic asset or an unpredictable liability? To answer these questions, we have to rewind to the very beginning of this story, the early 90s. As a child, Kim Jong-un was socially isolated. During the school year, he was confined to his family compound in Pyongyang, where he was taught by private tutors. His summers were spent on the beaches of Wonsan, North Korea's closest thing to Hawaii. Unable to make friends and forbidden from playing even with his half-brother, Kim developed an obsessive personality, fixated on planes, toy ships, and basketball. Then in 1996, at 12 years old, Kim was sent for schooling in Bern, Switzerland, under a fake name, where the regime bought 6 apartments in a diplomatic neighborhood. There, he was exposed to more Western culture. He began religiously wearing a Chicago Bulls jersey with Michael Jordan's number, 23, along with Air Jordans. A short child, his mother encouraged his fascination with basketball in hopes it would make him taller. Then one day, Kim Jong-un disappeared from school and never returned. He would emerge nearly a decade later in Pyongyang, climbing the ranks of power as his father's apparent successor. So few details were known about him at the time that his name was frequently misspelled, and age could only be approximated. Over in the States, this put the CIA in a dilemma: how to influence someone you know so little about. So they turned to his personal obsessions. They would attempt what they had done in 2000, when they brought his father, Kim Jong-il, a basketball signed by Jordan himself as a gift. Leverage America's cultural power by employing another Chicago Bull, this time Dennis Rodman. For reasons unknown, this idea never came to be. But it just so happened that the producers at the media company Vice also decided bringing one of Kim's childhood heroes was their best route into the country, where they wanted to film a new show. They brought the idea to Michael Jordan's agent, and separately, to envoys of North Korea's UN mission in New York. When talks with Jordan stalled, they had a problem. The North Koreans had already gotten their hopes up. So they lied, saying he was too afraid of flying. But they could bring none other than Dennis Rodman. This was perfect, not just because he played on the NBA Championship Series winning team during the exact window young, impressionable Kim studied in Switzerland, but also because Rodman had proven he would do anything for the spotlight. He had previously entered a wife-marrying contest in Finland, wrestled professionally, wrote books, and joined several reality TV shows. The North Korean diplomats then realized controversial Vice may not be the ideal company to portray their country, and demanded a meeting with HBO, who had bought the show, where they were given free Game of Thrones box sets. They agreed to move forward, mostly because it was already too late. Kim Jong-un had approved the visit, and disappointing him was not an option. The trip was on. And so it was that on February 26, 2013, Dennis Rodman, 3 Harlem Globetrotters, the Vice filming crew, and a handful of assistants flew the 6,000-mile route to Beijing and then Pyongyang. It was not, however, smooth sailing from there. On that very day after landing in Beijing, it became clear Rodman knew absolutely nothing about North Korea. His agent, not realizing the difference between the North and South, told him to expect a quick basketball game and some autograph signing, nothing out of the ordinary. This misunderstanding was accidentally broadcast to the world when Rodman tweeted that he might see Psy from Gangnam Style. Only when the North Korean military welcomed his arriving aircraft did he begin piecing things together. The following day, he was brought to a crowd-filled stadium for an exhibition game, where, all of a sudden, Kim Jong-un appeared, sat down next to him, and asked how he liked the country. Not knowing who exactly he was, Rodman replied, quote, "Yeah, it's fine, it's cool, it's okay." And just like that, he accidentally became the first high-profile American to meet Kim Jong-un. The two, along with Kim's wife, sat side by side, chatting through a translator and watching as teams were picked with a mix of Americans and North Koreans. The game ended in a 110-point tie. From that point forward, all hesitation was gone. It wasn't that Rodman was starstruck, he barely knew who Kim Jong-un was. Rather, a retired celebrity was reliving his glory days. Rodman had found a place, accidentally and strangely a brutal and secretive dictatorship, where he was treated like a god, and he could not get enough of it. This made it easy for him to ignore the North Korean propaganda. State media described Kim, quote, letting Rodman sit next to him. But all this fun caught up with him when he returned home. He went from being treated like, well, Kim Jong-un, to being ridiculed from all directions in the US, where he was called a traitor, a useful idiot, and far worse. It didn't help that the country had conducted a nuclear test only 2 weeks earlier. At first, Rodman portrayed his visit as purely a matter of basketball, that he had no special obligation to represent his country. Then, under increased pressure, he began embracing the image of a neutral third-party diplomat, asking his new friend to, quote, do me a solid and release Kenneth Bae, an American Christian missionary arrested in North Korea. He was quoted as saying, if I don't finish in the top three for the next Nobel Peace Prize, something's seriously wrong. Another embarrassing consequence of all this was that Dennis Rodman now had information that even the most senior experts and officials in Washington had sought for decades. His version of events could be biased, but it was also all they had. It was from his outbursts that the intelligence community later learned Kim's age and the name of his daughter. And in 99% of all possible realities, that's where this story would end, plenty outlandish as it is. But of course, this is Dennis Rodman, and he could not wait to return, so things got even more ridiculous. This time, he wanted to avoid the annoying Vice filming crew, but they had arranged the previous visit, leaving him with no avenue in. Then in comes Joseph Terwilliger, a Finnish-speaking, tuba-playing American professor of neurobiology teaching at a university in North Korea. Terwilliger bid $2,500 in an online charity auction to play horse with Rodman, who he met and told he'd be happy to help arrange a second trip. The two contacted a third man named Michael Spavor, a Korean-fluent Canadian who ran a North Korean tourism company and had a close relationship with Kim Jong-un, until he was later arrested in 2018 by the Chinese government. The DPRK Sports Ministry issued them visas, and in September 2013, Rodman returned. It was on this trip that Rodman had an idea, to put on a proper, competitive game in January for Kim Jong-un's birthday. He returned in December to pick the North Korean team and make arrangements for what would turn out to be the most controversial and disastrous trip of them all. This was the 2014 trip in which Rodman gave an impromptu speech and sang happy birthday in the Pyongyang Indoor Stadium. The Beijing-based Koryo Tours offered a $9,000 once-in-a-lifetime package with tickets to the game, which sold out in days. The Department of Treasury investigated Rodman's luxury gifts for sanctions violations, and the Obama administration said they would have prevented the trip if they had that power. The public reaction was severe. Kim Jong-un had executed his uncle only 1 month prior, and several of the accompanying NBA players said they regretted going at all. His contradictory image as both just an innocent guy visiting a place he loved, and simultaneously a diplomatic hero on a mission to save the world, only frustrated the American public more. He was seen as either profiting from an oppressive regime, or the naive pawn of a much larger geopolitical game. This confused and overwhelmed Rodman. Here he was, sacrificing his own reputation, attempting to make peace between two warring nations. Why was everyone being so hard on him? He reached a boiling point, exploding during a CNN interview. Once again, it seemed as though Rodman might never return to see his best friend. And once again, a new set of unlikely circumstances brought him back one final time 3 years later. In 2016, two at first unrelated things happened. First, Donald Trump was elected President of the United States. And second, an American college student on a guided tour of Pyongyang was arrested and sentenced to 15 years prison for stealing a propaganda poster. The one person who was connected to these two separate events was Dennis Rodman. Having appeared on Trump's reality TV show Celebrity Apprentice 7 years earlier, Rodman was the only human on Earth to have a relationship with both leaders. He was also useful for Kim Jong-un, as a distraction. On the same day that a secret American delegation flew to Pyongyang to retrieve their arrested citizen, Rodman played basketball in North Korea, bringing with him a copy of The Art of the Deal, although still not in any official capacity. Rodman says that although he continues being invited back, he's been asked not to go by his other friend Donald Trump. He did, however, fly uninvited to watch the 2018 Singapore summit. And it may only be a matter of time before he emerges again, renewing questions about trade-offs. The former NBA player says he's discussed his findings with the FBI, and his friendship certainly isn't the first national bond forged over a love of sports. Are the risks of an international incident, coupled with the propaganda win for the DPRK, offset by the intel he provides? That's a question we simply can't answer. But it certainly is entertaining. There are so many insane details, including some Rodman quotes and stories from his partying in North Korea, that I couldn't even mention in this video for fear of getting demonetized by YouTube, like my last video was. Which is exactly why I and your other favorite educational YouTubers created Nebula, where you can watch this video interspersed with those juicy details. All of my videos are posted there 100% ad-free, early, and now with bonus content, along with entirely exclusive Nebula originals like the YouTuber game show Money, hosted by Tom Scott. Even better, we've partnered with CuriosityStream, so for the same $15 a year price, you also get access to thousands of great documentaries like Pax Americana, about the fight between China and the US for militarizing space, or this one about why Google plans on scanning every book in the world. Sign up with the link in the description and you'll get an email with access to Nebula, so you can start supporting creators, watch great documentaries, and get the very best version of videos like this one.